Morning, brother. Glad to give our consideration to this very, very large topic here. One of the primary aspects of Revelation is the judgment of God. Since the rebellion of our race against his purpose here on the earth, there has been a specter, a rising, increasing specter of giving account to the Most High. Adam and Eve did in the beginning. He came walking. God came walking as he had done with them in the past in the garden to fellowship with them in the garden, and they hid themselves. And so there was an immediate accounting for things that they had done. They knew it was coming. They knew that they could not avoid his presence. He came to them and forced them to express, to expose themselves, so to speak. Where are you, Adam? Where are you? They had to speak. They had to respond to him. They could not hide themselves from him to whom they must give account. Scripture speaks that way, doesn't it? And numerous expressions like that throughout the entire revelatory record of giving account to God, him personally standing before him, answering to him, he himself, for he is the source, he is the means, and he is the end. As the apostle said, from him and through him and to him are all things. So this is the basis, the premise, the concept here of things in the earth. Now, we know, brethren, that the whole human race, whatever culture, whatever creed, whatever race, both genders, whatever age, whatever generation, everyone's concerned about what's right and what's wrong, aren't they, in one form or another. It's the constant topic, subject of media, communication. In the last generation or so, it's prolific, of course, with all the different forms and outlets and so forth of media. The news is about right and wrong, isn't it? Whether you're talking about politics or business, education, theories, philosophies, ideas of life, right and wrong. That's what we're talking about. Now, a lot of those who speak about it do not want to speak about it in stark terms. They don't want the black and white. They press away from that. They like to talk about everything being different and various shades of gray. It's as if there is no truth. And yet, they want to be the harbingers of truth, don't they? They want to talk about, there's something out there that's truth, you know. Now, here in America, of course, we vote about the truth, don't we? Everybody express their opinion, and we'll somehow, some way, in through the murkiness of it all, we'll come to truth, won't we? Well, that's what some think. All down through the generations and ages, God has revealed truth. We have a record of revealed truth. Now, people want to debate about it, we know. They want to fuss and discuss about why or whether or not we can believe this record. But it stands. It's there. It hasn't passed away. It hasn't gone off into the corner in the bookcases somewhere. It's still here. People have to focus on it. They have to give attention to it.
Even though there's been historically several efforts to totally remove it.
Eradicate it. Yeah. Yes, take it out of the... Remove it completely from the course of human conversation, human discourse, and boy, we'll just decide. We'll just decide what the truth is. We will decide what's right. We can do that because we're educated and we're smart. And we've developed all of these down to, especially in the last couple of generations, you know. But those who were paying attention and those who were honest, and we're just talking on a human level here, have to admit that from this human perspective, this horizontal view, things are just as murky as they've ever been. It really is. It really is. So the scripture stands then as a revelation, a standard. A standard by which measurement is made. Everyone would like to have that in a sense. The debate is, what is the standard? You know, this building we're setting in here, this structure that's over us, we appreciate the standards that were used in constructing it so it doesn't fall on our heads. The pews that you're sitting on were built according to certain standards. We appreciate that so that when we sit down on them, they hold our weight and they don't collapse under us. I'll appreciate that. See, down to the smallest detail of life, there's some kind of standard that's accepted, that's recognized. So when we talk about judgment here, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about a standard here and a decision being made on the basis of a standard. That this is right, and whatever deviates from that is not right. It's just not right.
Amen.
Okay? Now, in our American culture, we might talk about accepting certain things and agreeing, negotiating. You know, politicking and so forth, and negotiating, compromising about this and that and the other. But when it comes to this standard, there's no negotiation. There's no compromising. And it's made very clear, just the few instances Sister Debbie mentioned, it was very clear the judgment was imposed. A decision was imposed from without. Into this environment and into and over the lives of those who were involved. Those who were giving account to the Most High, to the judge of all the earth, as he's described again and again and again in this revelatory record. According to this record, there's no question whatsoever what the standard is, where it comes from, and what the end is. Now, men's interpretation of it, of course, will vary. But it is telling us these things, brother.
Yeah, this is very excellent to consider when you just state that judgment was imposed. Now, what does this do to man's will and things like this? See, there is a level at which this is the will of man that is ruled out, and this judgment is that one of those things. Yeah.
When you think about the will of man, that's what's being judged. Because a lot of us have heard this humorous statement and so forth. Somebody ought to write a book about this. Well, a book's already been written. And the message of the book is agree with me or go to hell. Agree with me. Yes.
Yeah, this shouldn't be thought strange by anyone. Judgment is part of the wharf and woof of our lives. You just, everyone is continually making judgments.
Yes.
They're making them for themselves. They're also making judgments that extend to their sphere of influence.
Yes.
What they will allow, what they won't allow, what they approve, what they disapprove, what they'll be involved in, what they won't be involved in. Your life is just a continual succession of judgments.
Yeah, absolutely.
The question is, are your judgments in agreement with and in subjection to the truth as it is in Jesus?
Yes. Amen.
And whether or not your judgments are leading you away from the knowledge of God or are drawing drawing you into the knowledge of God.
Yeah.
Because at some point, when judgments clash, there has to be some kind of resolution to the conflict.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you mentioned negotiation. That's not a resolution. That is a postponement.
Yes.
If things continue to go in their direction.
Mm-hmm.
Because people, depending on how opposite your judgments are, you continue to grow apart or together. Sometimes that postponement can allow for agreement to, you know, for a change in someone. But their only change, all of it, is on the side of mankind. Because God is truth.
Mm-hmm.
God is truth. He is reality. And so he can't change.
Yes.
We must change.
Yes.
Yeah. Amen.
Those who are unwilling to accept the revelation of these things, of this record that we have, of course, they can't conceive of the absolute nature of the things about which we're speaking. Now, this judgment, the great judgment, the day of judgment, that's what's before us. It's one of the things that's before us that we've chosen, and it's a primary thing, obviously. the good things that we've spoken about and so forth, they're going to come after this judgment. But there's going to come a day of, it's described as a day of reckoning. A day of reckoning, a giving account. As the text says here in 2 Corinthians 10, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. There you've got the standard there. There is a good, and there is a bad. Now, of course, everyone agrees with that. The only question is, what's the definition? What's the definition of the good and the bad?
One perspective, the day of judgment is going to confirm that God was right in his demands. He was right in his treatment of them. He is going to, God's going to be justified in all his sayings.
Yeah.
And then man, the outcome of man is going to be according to how he was in accord with.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's the bedrock, foundational, cornerstone premise of this revelation. That God is right, that God is true, and everything, everyone, we should say, because this involves people. It doesn't, you know, the trees, the plants, the animals are not involved in this conflict. They're caught up in it, but they're not involved in it. They're not making these decisions that either harmonize with or oppose God's will, God's nature, God's purpose. It is God's nature, by the way, not just his will. This is not just something that he decided about. This is who he is. It's a personal thing. We all understand that, don't we? It's a personal thing. When someone offends us personally, we sure understand that. That's what we're talking about here, is offending God personally. Now, in the cases of the scripture record, where God reveals his personal revulsion, his personal offense, as it's been said, it's not a pretty picture when he deals with it, when he resolves it, or when he removes it from the current environment. You might want to say it that way. He hasn't finally dealt with it. That's for the day. That's when he will finally deal with it. But he does remove it from the, you know, like we're talking about an athletic competition and so forth, some people are removed from the playing field. Well, that's what the scripture record tells us about some being removed from the field of action, from life. They're taken out of the way. God himself made that decision in the circumstance of in the account of Sodom and Gomorrah, in the account of Egypt, in the account of Sennacherib, outside the walls of Jerusalem, making his taunts at the people on the wall, and then returning the next morning. Of course, there was a little partial judgment, and then later he met his judgment in the earth. He met his judgment. And the record goes on and on and on and on. Israel, in the case of Israel, when Jerusalem fell, in the case of Judah, when Jerusalem fell, even though they were saying this is not going to happen, and even though they tried to assassinate Jeremiah for saying it was going to happen, it happened. And this is the temple of the Lord. The temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. See, it didn't matter what they thought. And their perspective, they said their perspective came from God's revelation. They were his people. This would not happen. Jeremiah, he's a wacko. He's a crazy man. He's imagined these things. He's being paid by the Babylonians to discourage all of us. You know, rationalization really, and the thinking would come from various perspectives and would go in various directions. But in the end, Jeremiah was God's man, and he was delivering God's message. See, the word of God stood when everything else fell down. That's what the judgment's about. The word of God will stand. The day of judgment, that signifies that there is a point, a real point at which this will happen. It is a day. We all understand a day. There is a place, a time, if you want to say it that way. There is a time, we often describe it as a place. To get a concrete concept in mind where this will take place. Where everyone, because people are involved, you see. Everyone will give account. They will answer to him. Not just an idea or a precept or a concept. They will answer to him. Amen. Him who speaks. Him who listens. He who listens. He who acts. He who loves. He who hates. He who values and treasures. He who rejects and abhors. A person. We're going to answer to someone. See? Now, for those of us who accept this revelation, it's a great comfort and encouragement. The more you understand, the more comforted and encouraged you are about it. Because God makes it very clear that those who love him, that those who love what he loves, that those who treasure and value what he treasures and values, that those who give themselves to these things, well, he will give himself to them. Amen. They have a great reward waiting from him. Amen. Because he's kind and he's good. And he's a giver. He gives and gives and gives and gives. He has always, according to this record, God has always rewarded those who have honor and respect to him. Yes.
In the case of Jeremiah, who was one such man that stood up against the nation, practically.
Yes, that's right.
And now these people had enough revelation that they should have been able to judge themselves. And instead, they judged the word of God evil and went after their own way. Mm-hmm. I don't say that lightly, because they sinned in the face of a lot of revelation. God had, they had previous judgments that they could look back at. Yeah. They saw the faithfulness of God. But because he's patient, they continued to wax worse and worse.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And we say this with fear and trembling, because except that we keep ourselves fixed upon the truth as it is in Jesus, we also would be found in this same condemnation and greater, because we would be sinning against a greater light. But going back to Jeremiah, in the midst of this great judgment, devastating from the human perspective, the destruction and the waste and the personal loss that mm-hmm. was experienced in this as God judged them according to their works. Mm-hmm. Jeremiah who was threatened by these people. Look at the care God took of him. Not only did he save him out of the judgment, but when they put him in that dungeon, God provoked this Ebed-Melech, who was an Ethiopian. He went and he spoke to the king, and it said, so Ebed-Melech took the men with him and went unto the house of the king under the treasury, and took thence old cast clouts and old rotten rags, and let them down by cords to the dungeon, into the dungeon to Jeremiah. And Ebed-Melech, the Ethiopian, said unto Jeremiah, put now these old cast clouts and rotten rags under thine arm holes under the cords. And Jeremiah did so, and they drew him up. Well, see, even down to the care of how he was delivered out of their hand. He was an older man, I think, wasn't he? I mean, not real ancient, but
Jeremiah?
Yeah, he wasn't like a young man.
Yes.
And he had been ill-treated by them. Mm-hmm. But even that care, instead of sticking an old rope there and pulling him up and hurting him and extracting him, he even caused them to take care.
Yes.
So that he wasn't hurt in the extraction. Mm-hmm. God is mindful of us in great detail.
Amen.
And it can be to our weal or our woe.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
So, from this broad perspective then, I wanted to introduce this from a broad perspective of right and wrong, of good and evil, and then the basis of this judgment. Those who talk a lot about judgment like it, as long as the judgment, of course, is on someone whom they deem as wrong and evil, or doing something wrong and evil. Now, a lot of these folks don't even like to talk about a person being wrong or evil. They just want to talk about, see how nebulous this has become, how dull it is from this perspective. They just talk about bad things, bad decisions, bad actions. The person's not bad, you see. No, no. When it comes to the revelation of God, it's the person that's bad. Now, they do bad things, but they do those bad things because they're a bad person. They're an evil person. They're a wicked person. Now, we can say that and no one understand that because we were that way. We understand that. Okay? You have to be willing to confess this, of course. And many are not willing to do that because this judgment, this decision about right and wrong gets real personal, doesn't it? Well, that's the point. See? We'll give account. We will each give account. And this text talks about that. Let's focus in on our text then. Paul's words in the early part of this, his third letter. Now, you remember there was one letter written that we don't have a copy of. We've got the second. This is the third one here now. He covers a wide range of topics from his reporting his circumstances to them, to mentioning previous letters, their current circumstances, the things that he's dealing with now. He's on his way, traveling to be with them again, and he sends his letter ahead, addressing certain things. But this letter, right after in the first two sections of it, the first two chapters, he talks about the circumstances there. Then his thinking gets larger and larger. He talks about, or he presses his points by contrasting the law of Moses and the gospel. He talks about his own gospel ministry. And then, by way of application, this section that we call chapter 5 here, he begins talking about the judgment and what is provoked in the heart of the believer because of understanding about what God has revealed, that all men will give account. And now in the gospel, you see, in the gospel message, all of this has been focused and pinpointed in the man, Christ Jesus. He himself spoke about these things. We'll mention his words as we go through this lesson. That he has a key role in this matter of the day of judgment. A man, of course, who came from God, a man who knew God, a man who in his own actions, in his own words, demonstrated what God is like. He who has seen me has seen the Father. The words that I speak are not my words, they're my Father's words. The works that I do are not my works, they're my Father's works. And he walked among us, and we saw his glory, the glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is how he's described. And this is how the Apostle Paul preached to them, to these believers in Corinth. So you see, there was a context, a line of thinking and reasoning in which he was addressing them, by which they could think, because he'd preached these things to them, and others had preached to them as well. Apollos had been there. He's a man learned in the scriptures. He could certainly talk about the judgment of God from a scriptural perspective. And then, of course, their apostle, Paul, who brought the gospel to them, their apostle, he was able to extend this and expand their understanding of these things. Things like he would have written to the Thessalonians that we have a record of Jesus' return and everyone's transformation at that time. The trumpet call of God and the voice of the archangel. He likely spoke about those same things there in Corinth. We know what he wrote in chapter 15, in the second letter, 1 Corinthians, what we call 1 Corinthians 15. These words about, let me turn to it here. I don't have it in my notes. I should have. But this is what they would have been able to reference. Chapter 15, verses 20-28. Now Christ is risen from the dead, has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. These echo Jesus' own words. You remember there from John 5. Each one in his own order. Christ the first fruits. Afterward those who are Christ at his coming. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father. When he puts an end to all rule and authority and power. That's judgment, see. He puts an end to all those who are under him. Peter talks about all these powers and authorities and angels being subject to Jesus. Well, that's what Paul's stating here, see. So in the context of judgment, they would have these words to refer to that he had previously written to them, and now he writes these words: we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. So this focus text then extends their thinking outside of their present, whatever their circumstances were. They were of little compared to him, standing before him to whom we must give account. And he reminds them of this, see. If they were paying attention, if they had a heart for understanding God's working and God's will and God's word, then this thought's primary. It should loom large in their perception of what God has revealed of himself. That there is a day, there is a time, and there is a place where we will meet God. And the scripture calls it the day of judgment, when the final revelation, according to this earth, the final revelation will be given. Sister June.
You can see the general disregard of this truth that you're expounding this morning. The fact that there is a judgment by the general disregard and disrespect of Jesus himself.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You have people who use his name loosely.
Yes.
People who take his name in vain by attaching it to themselves and then living contrary to him. People are not mindful of him. They're not respectful. See, if they knew this truth, they would have respect unto the one who will sit in judgment of them.
That's right.
He is the one.
That's exactly
right.
So anyone who does not hold Jesus in high regard is ignorant concerning these things.
Amen. Amen. Mm.
Brother James, the putting off of our body and receiving the body not made with hands doesn't relieve us of the responsibility of the deeds we've committed in the old body.
Yes.
It's going to be brought up. You're going to stand there in your new body and give an account for the things you did in your old one.
Mm-hmm.
And now I like to, nobody should have a problem with this, where it says, for we all shall. Everyone that's ever committed any acts in the old body is going to have to give an account to the one that gave them the strength to do anything in anybody.
Yes.
I think right along those lines, I've had some recent personal experiences in this, but if you've ever read the Confessions of Augustine, you can think back of your life and you'll think of things you would have God you didn't do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You can actually take that now, maybe it happened like in my case 60 years ago. You take it now and you go, the blood of Christ, he purged your conscience.
That's right.
And so you can come before the judge having it thoroughly addressed that. Mm-hmm. But I remember a host of things I did when I was young, and frankly, I hadn't thought about in years. There were wickedness. And so this is what I did. This came to me, being helped along by this book by Augustine, to go back and revisit the things that you do have legitimate regrets about.
Yes.
Yeah.
You can go back and take him before the Lord. He can cleanse your conscience so that you will not be condemned on the day of judgment for that.
Amen.
Amen.
This is part of why we have this revelation.
That's right.
Can deal with these ahead of time.
Amen.
Or lay them before the Lord and let him deal with them. Mm-hmm. See, this is submission to him. This is an aspect of faith, confession, repentance, all of these things work in our favor because God has revealed to us that we can do these things, that he's willing to receive those of a contrite heart. He draws near to those with a contrite heart.
Sister. This is a first fruits, if you will, of the judgment.
Yes.
We are actually being involved as we repent and our appeal to the Lord for this clear conscience, the clean conscience, that this is the judgments of God being affected even now. It's like a precursor of, like, if you take care of it now, but it's going to happen at some point. It won't be left unresolved, but God is merciful, and now I don't know how it's going to be brought up, but I take great comfort in God's modesty in concerning his references to evil, and I know that on that day, the saints are not going to be ashamed.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Amen.
Now this should once and for all remove any question about whether God wants to condemn people or not.
Mm-hmm.
See,
if
he did, he would not make this known.
That's true. Yes.
But this
just wipe us all away.
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But he's made a revelation of these things. So now, in the immediate context of Paul's words, here's how he leads up to this. He says, earth's dwelling, this body is temporary. That God provides a permanent dwelling, another body. Again, this is real personal, isn't it? We're not talking about buildings and dwelling places, you know, out here. This is us. This is really us. So the old body's gone, a new body has come. And he provokes the heart by saying that believers long for this permanent dwelling of God. Faith does. This is the natural trajectory or project of faith is to take hold of that for which we have been taken hold of in Christ Jesus. He says it another way in another letter. So believers long for this permanent dwelling. Faith prepares you for this dwelling of God. Hope will engender confidence in God's revealed will and purpose in these matters, and love will target them. See, your love of God, your love of the truth, your love of the same things that he loves, it will enable you to target, that's what I want, I'm going for it.
Amen.
That's a little rough way to say it, but that's what it comes down to. Amen. That you will aim for this destiny.
Amen.
Because we're involved, you see. This is a personal matter. It's a personal matter. So then we come to these to our primary text then. And I want to mention this at the beginning here. That right after he makes a statement about the judgment of God, the judgment seat of Christ, his next statement is, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord. See? There's more to come. There's more to come. And this restatement of this primary aspect, that all things are moving, everything is moving toward that appointment.
That's right. Amen.
Amen.
See, from one perspective, the death of the body is not the ordinary death of the body that we think about is not part of this. Because it may come in when we're still alive. When we're still here, going about our daily tasks and so forth, and God will interrupt time. The sky will open, and his son will appear on the clouds with his angels and flaming fire. And judgment will be here. Everything will be, all business, all politics, all social issues, everything will end right then at that point, at that time. It's the day. The voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God. This is it. This is it, see. Yeah. So here we are. Now, I've developed this lesson by posing some questions here from the text. Let me state them for you before we get started. I don't know how many of them we'll get through. I intend to get through all of them, but we'll see. Why must we all appear then? It says we will. We must all appear. Why must we all appear? What about those who are dead prior to this? Why is it Jesus' judgment seat? We're talking about the judgment of God, but Paul states that it's the judgment seat of Christ. And by what authority is his judgment? See? And why is this place and time called a judgment seat? And does the phrase "that each one may receive," does it mean it's personal? Well, I've said that, haven't I? I've said that. We'll flesh that out a little bit. What are the things done in the body? Who gives reward of the things done in the body? And then one last one. What will those who receive it do with that reward? It's not something you're just going to put on a shelf. It's given for something. So why must we all appear? Justice is defined as properly a verdict, favorable or unfavorable. A decision is made. It's pronounced judicially. A sentence or a formal decree. Now again and again and again in different ways through this revelatory record, the scripture record, the writings that God gives us. These precious words of the prophet, thus says the Lord, who created the heavens, who is God, who formed the earth and made it, who has established it, who did not create it in vain, who formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord. That's pretty clear, isn't it? There is no other. I have not spoken in secret. In a dark place of the earth. I did not say to the seed of Jacob, seek me in vain. See, they're the object, the primary object of this revelation from God. They were the ones who received it. It was entrusted to them for them to make a record of it and to keep that record. And we have it as a result of their faithfulness and God's working in them. We have that record. We're reading it now. I have not spoken in secret in a dark place of the earth. I did not say to the seed of Jacob, seek me in vain. I, the Lord, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right. Tell and bring forth your case. Let them take counsel together. Who has declared this from ancient time? who has told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? There is no other God besides me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. I have sworn by myself, the word has gone out of my mouth in righteousness and shall not return, that to me every knee will bow, every tongue shall take an oath. So that's just one statement from the prophet Isaiah, 700 years before Jesus. Sister Jean.
We're looking at that from the perspective of the final judgment of God.
Yes.
God is light, and in him is no darkness at all.
Yeah.
This the whole of salvation is intended to make God known.
Yes.
And so in not allowing, even in the most infinitesimal detail, anything that is wrong slip by. See, we're seeing the pure light of God in this. After the judgment, there's going to be nothing that will be left in question in anyone's mind.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't really deal with that, did we? Or I wonder what God would have said about that. Or that seemed to have slid by. No, it's going to be as perfect in its manifestation as God is perfect in light.
Yes.
It's going to be all made known because God is bringing himself to bear on all his works.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, the record of the Psalms, there are numerous statements there. I've got 4 or 5 here. He shall judge the world in righteousness. He shall administer judgment for the peoples in uprightness. He is coming, for he is coming to judge the earth. He shall judge the world in righteousness, the people in his truth. For he is coming to judge the earth with righteousness. He shall judge the world and the peoples with equity. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Mercy and truth go before your face. Clouds and darkness surround him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. So that lays the groundwork for us then about why we must all appear. Because God cares about what's good and true and right. He cares about that. And he's watching. Remember Job called him the watcher of men? He's watching. He was watching Noah's generation. He was watching Sodom and Gomorrah. He was watching Abraham and his descendants, of course, his seed. He was watching over them. He was watching. He appeared to Jacob and said, go down to Egypt. Go down to Joseph. Joseph shall close your eyes there. He was watching over his people during that 4 centuries in Egypt. God was watching over. See? And so the record overflows with this to communicate to us that God is involved. He's paying attention. And all will give account to him. He can interject by his power. He can interject his wisdom and his truth at any point which he chooses. And he does again and again and again down through human history. Now, the descendants of Abraham, his friend, of course, were intimately involved in this. And they become for us then an object lesson, if you will. Because Peter states it, judgment begins with the household of God. It begins there. It doesn't end there, but it begins there. So, now, by our faith in what God has said and done, our hope in him that he is a Savior, he is not willing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. He takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that they would turn. And he's drawn to those who have a contrite heart. Though he dwells in a high and holy place, he is drawn to those who have a contrite heart. So all of these statements then give us hope. And then we have one who became flesh, who took up a body that was prepared for him. All these things revealed to us, see. All these things made known to us. And he came, and he demonstrated in his own life some aspects of the judgment of God, and that it will happen, it will take place. He spoke clearly, specifically and directly to the people of God. He was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, wasn't he? He didn't go up into Asia Minor. He didn't go down into Egypt to preach and to teach and to do his works. He was there for a short time. He didn't travel over into India, other Persia, other places like that, across the Roman Empire. Didn't travel to Italy and Rome to make his statement before the Caesar. No, he stayed right there in that little place and walked from village to village, from town to town, speaking and preaching and teaching like no man had ever done before, demonstrating the truth and the wisdom of God, the righteousness and goodness of God, and also the mercy and kindness of God. Brother.
The extent to which God has allowed himself to be offended by the human race.
It really is.
But the reason he's done it is to show these other aspects of, mm-hmm. of himself. There's no other way for God to reveal this but that he allows someone to sin against, or the race to sin against him and be offensive to him. Otherwise, how do we know God is merciful? Or know his long suffering, or his righteousness,
yes.
or his ability and willingness to save, mm-hmm. or that God is love. This is how all that is revealed. And so then the judgment is a matter of whether men took advantage
yes.
or not of what God has revealed about us.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, when you think about this patience of God. Go ahead, brother.
We've talked about this before. It should be man's sole preoccupation to seek after God. Matter of fact, the judgment, the day of judgment, is a proper conclusion to all things. This is God's going to be a divine evaluation of the earth, of those who sought after him like you told them to, like you put it out there for them to do. You know, we had Jeremiah the prophet even said it's not in a man to direct his steps.
Yes.
So we've been told you don't know how to walk. And so God has provided these judgments along the way. But mm-hmm. the final judgment is going to be a proper way to end it.
Mm-hmm.
God superintends to all the men how they've done.
Amen. Amen. So our existence here on the earth then, and get back to this patience that Brother Mike mentioned, that provoked a lot of thinking into me. Our earthly involvement, our earthly existence involves the competition of good and evil, of righteousness and wickedness, of truth and lies in us, people's hearts sifted and back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And God's patience, for instance, in the days before Noah, each generation being 700 to 900 centuries, the lives of these men, waiting, as each generation degenerated, for the most part. There was some righteousness and some goodness. God, he'd made no formal revelation. It was just that men knew that some things were right and some were wrong. But as they pursued their own appetites, their own interests, Their own lives, their own culture just fell apart. Degenerated into nothing but violence and every imagination of their hearts being evil continually. That's the Holy Spirit's assessment of the situation. And then God intervened with a judgment. Just to let everybody know that he was paying attention.
Picture of wrath. Mm-hmm. See, so in salvation, it's all calculated to demonstrate to every characteristic of God that is pertinent to the salvation of man has been demonstrated throughout
yes.
history in some way, so that if a person takes due note of it, it will help them to adequately prepare when all these traits are going to
yes.
be
yeah.
not only made known, but justified. God was right in all of these responses.
Yes, yeah, yeah. So we must all appear for that. We must all stand before him. And he's told us again and again and again and again down through the generation. None will stand there and say, but I didn't know. No. The warnings were given. The warnings have been established. The question will be, why did you not pay attention? See? Why didn't you listen? Why didn't you heed the warning? Didn't you heed the warning? So, we must all appear then before him who is righteous and just. That's the, righteousness and justice, the foundation of his throne. Now that's his authority, see? That's his authority in doing these things. So, what about those who are dead prior to that then? Paul deals with that, of course. Don't want you to be ignorant, brethren, he says, 1 Thessalonians 4, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who are asleep in Jesus. You remember this account? Behold, the veil of the temple was torn from top to bottom. The earth quaked. The rocks were split. The graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the city and appeared to many. Now that's just a little testimony, see, the overflow of the power of his life. After his resurrection, others were raised as well. No names, no numbers, just a record that this was just a small overflow of the power of his life. Yes, yes. And it's announced in other places, of course. Now, this is the personal nature of this. This is the one whose glory we have seen. We have the record of his life, the things he did. We have the testimony of the eyewitnesses, those chosen witnesses who went out and spoke and preached these things, and then they were able to say, we ate and drank with him. We saw him after he was alive. So we've got their words. We have their record. Okay? So the Spirit then takes and works in the honest heart to profit the Most High. And to profit us as well, to benefit us, because that will help us to prepare for this time, see. So, he has the keys of death and the grave. Now, he demonstrated this in the earth. Young man, I say to you, arise. Little girl, get up. Lazarus, come forth. See, he had the keys of death and the grave then. How much more that he has entered into it and returned again.
Amen.
And just this overflow, see. So those whose bodies expire between now and then, they will return again. And all will give again. This is not just about us who will be alive at his return.
Yeah, that's what the psalmist has been referring to. It said, there go forth very precious seed shall doubtless come again.
Yeah, there you go. That's one application of that.
That's right.
Yes, it absolutely is. It's not just talking about life here in this world, our present existence, our present environment, not at all. Yeah.
Just imagine.
Mm-hmm. Yes. What do you think? See, that an object lesson of this is, now we know that life does not consist of everything that we are and everything that we do here in little old Joplin, Missouri. Because we all know people in other places, don't we? We all have family members in other places. We have brethren in other places around the world. We communicate with them. Some of us have been there, gone there and met them, sat in their houses, spoke with them, shook hands with them, prayed with them. See, this is not the only time and place. Not at all. So, why is it Jesus' judgment seat? See, we've gone from the judgment seat of God to now the apostle declares this is the judgment seat of Jesus. Judgment seat of Christ. This Savior. Well, the Father judges no one. These are his words. You recognize them. The Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son. That all should honor the Son Just as they honor the Father, he who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. He who hears my words and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life, shall not come into judgment, but is passed from death unto life. The hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. The judgment seat of Christ. The Apostle Paul declared there in Athens, without apology, without hesitation, he just looked him right in the eye and said, he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained or appointed. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. That's the proof, see? Jesus' resurrection is the proof. He doesn't mention any proof about Jesus' resurrection, does he? His resurrection is the proof. That's a different perspective. For those of us who have been exposed to certain things in the religious environment, religious world, about proofs and evidence, huh? The resurrection is an evidence of the judgment day of God. Jesus said for months and months and months that he would come out of the grave after 3 days. He taught it to his disciples. He told them. Even his enemies knew, didn't they? He said that after 3 days he would rise again. Put a guard on the tomb. But that only gave more evidence, didn't it? Because those who were at the tomb told the truth at first, until they were paid to lie. They told the truth. They came and reported to their superiors what happened. And it was not what, they did not want that message out in the public. So they paid them a large sum of money. And the false message then was spread to the people, even to this day. Even to this day, it was said. But this message also went out. They couldn't stop the message, could they? Because we cannot but speak what we have seen and heard. You judge whether it is right for us to obey God rather than you, or you rather than God. That's what Peter said to the Sanhedrin. You judge about it. See, there are judgments that we make every day. They were making a judgment. You men, stop preaching in his name. We told you not to speak in his name. They were making a judgment, see? So the disciples made a judgment as well.
Told not to pray in his name.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The answer has been a little bit different than
in some cases.
John.
Yeah.
Now this thing of Jesus being the judgment seat of Christ, that means that God has given man every conceivable advantage. So you've got a man going to judge men. So
yes.
So that, that's every possible advantage is given.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He did this in a body prepared for him. He learned to be obedience here in the earth, and he finished his work here and then returned to the Father. Because that's the place where the foundation, and he himself, of course, is the cornerstone now. It's not just a concept or an idea about righteousness and justice. It's a person. It's a person. He is the cornerstone who was laid, who was cut and laid by the Father in the earth. Over which the prophet said, of course, over which men stumble and fall. And it's described, the stone is described as one on which we can fall and be broken, or under which all will be crushed. Now we know how Jesus received, how Jesus responded to people who came to him and wanted to fall, don't we? He received them. He didn't turn anyone away. Don't touch me, woman. No. Your sins are forgiven. Your faith has saved you. Go in peace. See? Because that woman recognized that he was the cornerstone. And it was right to submit and to humble herself before him and to make this confession, brother.
Now, there are a great many qualities of God, but you notice the prevailing quality by which God is going to judge the world is in righteousness.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
He doesn't say he'll judge the world in love.
Yeah.
He's going to judge it in righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
seems to me one of the reasons why is because the context of the righteous standard of God is the context in which the greatness of what Jesus did when he died for the world is made known. And so judgment will be passed in favor of those who have taken advantage of what Jesus has done, and judgment will be passed against those who haven't.
Yeah.
Amen.
And under that, from that perspective, then we also see the love of God demonstrated toward us. See, but that's an inside view. That love of God's an inside view, as we've said, sister.
He's already told us what the judgment is going to be. Mm-hmm. He said that this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil, and they would not come to the light.
Yes.
Now, he's already said, you do this, the judgment is condemnation. That's what you can expect.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah, he's made that revelation. Brother Ball.
Yeah, this fact that Brother Gibbon brought this up, so to you, concerning that God's going to be justified in all of his works. Now, this here in Romans 9, see, this is going to have to be answered. It says, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth, that's going to have to be demonstrated. See, that's going to have to be proved. Then it's delivered. It says, is there unrighteousness with God? See, this is going to be brought out at the judgment. There was no unrighteousness with God. Every single person that he enlightened, he gave grace to, it was for a reason. This is all going to be brought up. And the books are compared, the books of life compared to the books of the works of men and the works of God. It's all going to be harmonious.
Yes.
And God's going to be justified in all of his works. And it's going to be seen. Mm-hmm. Now, some people may have a hard time with this. But then, they won't then. They'll see.
Yeah.
The works of God are just and holy and right. And it'll be acknowledged. Every man will acknowledge that God is right.
Amen. Amen. One more statement then about Jesus being the judge here. The prophet says, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding. See, this is the one who's judging, but he has a spirit of wisdom and understanding. And he demonstrated this in the earth, in all kinds of little personal matters that he dealt with. He demonstrated this, spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge, the fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, nor decide by the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, faithfulness the belt of his waist. It's the judgment seat of Christ, you see. And he demonstrated all these things. Okay, what's the authority of his judgment? Well, it's the authority of God. God said, this is my son, in whom I am well pleased. Then he said it again and added that. Listen to him. Hear him. The voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. So the Father has his seal upon him in these matters. The Father and the Son did this. The Son came and the Father revealed him. And the Son then reveals the Father to those to whom he is pleased. He is pleased to reveal him. See, it's not all our decision. Mr. June.
But Jesus told us exactly. He said, speaking of the Father, and hath given him authority to execute judgment also because he is the Son of
he
Man.
He is the Son of Man. Yeah. Primary statement. He's walked here among us.
That's right.
And he pleased the Father in all things, tested in all points as we are yet without sin. And then he returned to the Father.
It isn't that God wouldn't be fair.
That's right.
Is that Jesus is going to make sure he's perceived?
Yeah.
Yes.
See,
at
the day of judgment, everybody's going to know.
So we understand.
And for some, it'll be their damnation, it'll be a grievous day. But that's going to know. The data is not going to end until every single personality ever created by God knows God was right.
Yes. Yeah, right. Amen.
Well, Hebrews develops the fact that, that Jesus was prepared by, I mean, he, like being the high priest,
yeah.
There were aspects of his life that you that actually put him in a place of, well, he was the exact one. He had to fulfill all the requirements of this judge in order for God's justice to be effected perfectly so that there couldn't be any little loopholes, any little places where anybody could raise an accusation to God about anything. It had to answer the condemnation upon the human race. The soul that sinneth, it shall die, and that man, by man, sinned into the earth.
Mm-hmm.
As someone who could represent us properly before the Father and execute the perfect will of God. See, all of these things are involved and more in the fact that Jesus is the Savior. And that's involved in that statement because he is the Son of Man. It's because he fulfilled every requirement of being a perfect judge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amen.
Men have not always been able to see. Remember when Uzzah was struck dead when he...
Yes.
David was angry with God because God did that.
Yes.
See, well, the day of judgment, you say. That's why this man, Christ Jesus, he's gonna cover it from a human perspective. He's gonna show God at the perspective of the Creator, so nobody's gonna have any question about
yes.
this.
Yes.
Why hast thou done this?
Mm-hmm. So the authority that Jesus expressed and exerted while he was here, it was God's authority. He demonstrated that. The judgment seat, why is it called the judgment seat? Because there's a place where, and we've already stated this a number of times, there's a place, a time and place where all this will be settled. That gives great comfort to us. If you pay attention to the world and you care about what's right and true from God's perspective, this will be settled. That's a great comfort to know. And that God's righteousness and his justice, it's not being adjusted or curved based on human interests or human needs. No, it's God's name. For his name's sake, see, over and over again, the prophet Ezekiel, that was spoken to the prophet Ezekiel, for my name's sake, see. So those whose message is primarily focused on human interests and human needs and so forth, I read something just a few minutes ago in a magazine out here, where someone that we don't know, not a part of our association and so forth, in the media, a Christian writer in the media addressed this very issue about people who don't speak about sin. Preachers who don't speak about sin.
Yeah.
And don't address this issue that's so obvious. It's in all of us. But see, if your intent is to attract and hold a crowd, if that's your intent, then that's going to shape your message.
Right.
But if your intent is to justify God and to show his righteousness and justice and truth and goodness, then that will shape your message. So this is why we have to speak about these things. We have to speak about this issue of the judgment of God and what he has made known. The judgment seat. These things will be settled. And the prophet says, when you see this, your heart shall rejoice. And your bones shall flourish like grass. The hand of the Lord shall be known to his servants, his indignation to his enemies. See, this is that revelation. It's going to be confirmed. It's going to be nailed down.
That's right. Amen.
At this judgment seat. Now the personal nature that each one may receive. Remember the Savior's parables? There's a couple of statements there. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. Another one. The kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his servants, delivered his goods to them. To one he gave five, to another two, five talents, to another two, to another one. To each according to his own ability, and immediately went on a journey. And he who had received the 5 talents went and traded them, made 5 talents. Likewise, he had received 2, gained 2 more also. He had received the 1, went and dug in the ground, hid his Lord's money. And after a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with him. Now, everyone listening, including us, we understand what that means. A giving account, responsibility for actions. So they stood before the owner and gave account. Each one of us shall give account of God to account of himself to God, Paul said in Romans 14:12. Each one shall bear his own load, he wrote to the believers in the churches in Galatia. Each one, what they've chosen, so to speak, will receive what they've chosen. What they loved, what they gave themselves to. We know that's what people do, don't we? They give themselves to what they love, what they care about. Now, some people may only care about blocking out the knowledge of God. That's all they care about. And so they seek out something that will help them do that. To just make it all a blur, make it go away, make the pain go away, make those thoughts go away. I don't want to think about that. I don't want to think about anything. And so they get to the place where they're living out of a bottle or out of an alcohol bottle or a pill bottle or some other form, you know. And their whole life centers on that. Now, that's the gutter kind of things. But then there are levels of all kinds of other things that people do. They pursue those things. They give themselves to those things. Deeds done in the body, that each one may receive the things done in the body. The Apostle Paul warned the believers there in Galatia, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man sows, that will he also reap. This is a big statement now, we know. He who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. The things done in the body. Those things are revisited and laid alongside God's truth. See, and a measurement is taken. And an account is given. Things done in the body. Who gives this reward for things done in the body? Well, it's him who is sitting on the judgment seat. Him. All authority and all power are granted to him in heaven and on earth. He reveals all things. He opens. He closes. All of these things are given into it. All judgment is given to the Son. See? He stated that, and the apostles affirmed that again and again and again and again in their writing, in their preaching and teaching. And ours had better do that as well. Our preaching and teaching had better do that as well. Yes. Reminding everyone. Now, again, your intent and your purpose is going to shape your message. Is it God's intent and purpose? We have to ask ourselves. Have I given myself to his, what he has revealed that he is doing, which we're able to do, see, we're able to, Jeremiah did it, Ezekiel did it, Daniel did it, Joseph did it, the list goes on and on and on. They gave themselves to God, and he did mighty works in them. Daniel, well, he went to the heights, didn't he? And he also went to the depths in his desire to honor and please God over any other. He stood before Nebuchadnezzar and said, O king, you need to repent. You think there was anybody else in the king's court that spoke that way to him? His wives didn't even speak that way to him. We know. Nobody spoke that way to Nebuchadnezzar. Is this not my great city, the great palace that I've made for the glory of my majesty? Now, see, that was Nebuchadnezzar's attitude before he went into graduate school for a period of time. And he did graduate, it seems. You know, we have his thesis there. Doesn't take you long to read it. You know, this is the deductions of what he'd learned while he was there in class. And it was an international, so to speak, an international proclamation. Think of that, a king in this position who most people never even saw him. They never even saw him. But here comes this edict out of the palace about a god from their perspective, a god of a little nation Some of them might have heard about them. Some of them may even know a few of these people. But Nebuchadnezzar's writing and a kingdom-wide revelation, edict, about what he'd learned about this God. How many other kings do you suppose wrote religious theses like that and published them? This is a pagan king, see, a pagan king. Things done in the body. God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him, the scripture says. He gives a reward. And the scripture record is abundantly clear. To his friend, God said, I am your very great reward. And the scripture record closes by reminding us that God will dwell among them and be with them. And that his people will dwell with him and they will see his face. The one who shook the earth, the one who revealed to Moses, no man can see my face and live. But the record closes by saying we will see his face. He will be among us and in us, his people. A reward of things done in the body. Finally then, what will the righteous do with that reward? That thought occurred to me. Is that just the end of it then? We're all just going to sit down now and look at what we've received. No, not so. Not so. We will enter into the joy of our master with that reward. You see, to a place prepared for us from the foundation of the world. This is not an afterthought. It is a place prepared for those who are prepared. From him, through him, and to him are all things. See, he's been preparing us. He's been preparing us. Appointed in robes of righteousness provided by the Father, that place will be a world where an existence, an environment where God's righteousness dwells without end. It fills it. Everything there is right. You want to fit there, you better be right. You better be right according to his judgment, his justice, his righteousness. That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Think of that. This one who walked among us, brother.
I don't doubt that the reward will have a lot to do with our role in eternity.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be something we use rather than something that's just displayed.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
The Revelation says, and his servants shall serve him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you can see how this, as you serve God here, you're given grace appropriate to your function.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's going to be enlarged in the world to come.
Yeah.
The reward will compensate for what's needed for that.
Yes. Yeah. Another realm, another world.
Mm-hmm.
A new heavens and a new earth. So we just kind of skipped across the top of this. Let me conclude here by reading the words of our brother Daniel. Recorded in chapter 7, I watched till thrones were put in place and the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow and the hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. 1,000 thousands ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated and the books were opened. As I was watching, and behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away. His kingdom, the one which shall not be destroyed. That's just one of the many pictures that were given then. Any other comments, brethren, from you this morning? This has been a broad, wide-ranging discussion in some ways, but it's just to help us establish us, confirm these things in us, of what God has intended, what God has planned. Brother Aaron. Yes. Yes. Yeah. It comforts and encourages us in that sense. Any other things then? Thank you all for your comments. Very good. Let's pray together then. We'll take a break.